Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath to each and one of you. Again, it is a delight to be back home, to be here in Monterey Bay Academy. I recognize some faces, but some of you are new, and before we have the official welcome, I did want to do a warm welcome on behalf of the Monterey Bay Academy Church and MBA community to the Emerald Seventh-day Adventist Academy, who is visiting us this week. Now, some of you might wonder, why are they here if there's no students? There's no classes, there's nothing going on. Well, believe it or not, they are here thanks to Build and Restore Ministries, where they have come all this week to volunteer and to serve in a local mission. Now, some of you, when you walked in, you probably noticed, no, we didn't forget about the mess as you came in. It's just there's been a lot of work happening here on our campus, on our church, everywhere you go. All of these students, raise your hand, students over there, and some of the adults that are here, they've been here all week working really hard to fixing, cleaning, painting, you name it. And so you can see some of it, some of the stuff that we're still working on right at the entrance. And so I want to thank you guys for coming in this week. Last week we had another group that came in, but the Emerald Academy, they actually said, you know what, Pastor, we want to help you guys out with the church service. So that today they are leading in song service, students are preaching, and so we want to thank you so much for doing this today. So as you can see, we have a very empty church today, but that's only because everybody is in spring break. But everybody that's here this morning, I just want to thank you so much for being here. We love that you're here, and so I hope that you can enjoy today's program. May God bless you, and I want to ask my brother to come forward.
Thank you, Pastor, and thank you, congregation. It's really been a beautiful time that we've been able to have. It's nice to be here on this beautiful campus. You guys get a little bit more sunshine than we get up there in Oregon, especially this time of the year. For us coming down, we left Sunday, 7 o'clock in the morning, and drove down here. And as we were coming in through Northern California, it was really beautiful to see Mount Shasta in all of its glory, all the snow, and as you go through Shasta Lake, that full reservoir. You know, for us, I know that one of the things that we do, we have weekly newsletters, and one of the things that I had done for our local school family was talking about the many blessings and kind of comparing it to some of the reservoirs in California, kind of looking at the before and the after. And you know, you think about blessings, isn't that the truth? Sometimes we have those moments in our lives where we feel like our reservoirs are really, really drained down. But then God has a way of blessing us, bringing blessings into our lives. And really, that's what we tried to do this week for you as a school and as a community, to share not only our students and their talents, but also just be a blessing for your community. So as we start our service, you're going to hear from some special music from our group. We're going to lead out in some opening songs with guitar, and we're also going to have four sermonettes, and then I'll have a closing thought. But right now, I want to turn your attention to Ostop, and I'm going to let him talk a little bit more about not only maybe his organization, but some of the things that we've been doing.
Good morning, good morning. Happy to see each one of you. It's a blessing to be back at MBA. This is our annual retreat, per se, as we bring different groups to help, to contribute, to volunteer, to learn together. And, you know, many have asked this week, what is going on in Ukraine? And I figured, well, it would be fitting to show you some pictures from Ukraine and help you to see firsthand what is going on over there, and you know, how is God interacting and intervening in the midst of a crisis, in the midst of a war, right? If you can imagine yourself, it's 5 a.m. and some have began to wake up to get ready for their morning routine, and all of a sudden you hear a siren, and before you know it, just a few minutes after the siren, there's bombs exploding left and right of you, missiles falling from the sky, and people are in shock. They have no idea what's going on. And that's really how the war started in Ukraine just on a random morning at 5 a.m. And it's been going on now over a year. And some of it's popular news, some of it isn't, and it's just kind of hit and miss right now with the time that's elapsed from the beginning. But there are some takeaways that I want to share and a few things that I've observed as we've sent volunteers and groups to go and help and to minister to the people there in Ukraine. When volunteers call me to go on a mission trip, usually it's to either a tropical country or somewhere warm like here in California by the beach, or maybe to Mexico to work at an orphanage. But this past year, I've had multiple phone calls that came in and said, I want to actually go to Ukraine and volunteer. And it kind of makes me feel nervous and happy all at the same time. Because do you take on the responsibility to send someone to a war-torn country and they may not return? At the same time, they feel the burden from God that says, I should go and help. And so do you say, well, you shouldn't go. God's not really telling you. So how do you act in those moments? How do you confirm with the people that are calling you that they're not just looking for a thrilling adventure that could cost them their life, but they're actually going to go and serve and volunteer and help those in need? So I'm going to show you just a couple of pictures of what's going on over there. This is a map. You'll see some of the red areas that have been occupied by Russia. And this is where they're coming in. So this is the country in large, and you can see the eastern side is getting penetrated both from the southeastern side and also from the northeastern side, and even from the north up from where the other countries are that are neighboring. So really just the western side has really been untouched. All of the east has been at one way or another impacted by this war. Well, I want to show you a couple of pictures that some friends of mine took as they went to volunteer there to help contribute. This is a train station that's completely flooded with people, and this train station is on the west of the country, and so everybody from the east jumped on an available train, standing room only, and they took the long journey of 4 days across the country to get over to the west. And our churches have been turned into missions. They're hosting people, they're distributing food, people lodging in local churches. All the pews have been moved aside, put aside, and there's bedding and cots that have been set up for people to be able to see and utilize the space that's there. This is a bakery that's been baking 24/7. They have three different shifts. The oven is hot the whole 24 hours as they're baking bread and distributing to the areas of need. And then smaller vehicles package and box items into boxes and distribute to those villages that are in shortage. And food supply has been a task to tackle because it's been difficult to distribute food. Bridges have been blown up, roadways have been destroyed. Those type of challenges exist. And so in the middle of the night, when there's less activity from the military, they're able to transport some of this food and get out to places of need. This is one of my uncles that's still there in Ukraine, and he's working over there distributing food. And then as the vehicle is empty coming back, then he's taking people out of harm's way, out of the east onto the western side. Boxes and boxes. They've distributed over 300,000 boxes of food now. And generous donors and sponsors will call and say, I want to sponsor 50 boxes of food, or I want to sponsor a truck of grain to be distributed in Ukraine to help those that are hungry and in need. Homemade gas stations have been made in the back of minivans and utility vans so they can fill up each other's cars and get from point A to point B. Gas stations were running out of fuel. It was a challenging time. So those that could go out further from the areas that were not impacted as heavily and find gas stations that had gas, would put them into these vehicles and then transport them across to the areas that did not have gas. Really interesting story. At the train station, there were volunteers handing out glow tracks and some literature for people to read as they're just huddled there at the train station waiting for their next destination. And they had water bottles that they were giving out. And as people were coming off the train, they would stand with a water bottle and a glow track. And more times than not, people would take the glow track and not take the water bottle. The lesson learned here, if you rewind a year or two back and you were in the same train station and you had a water bottle and a glow track, it'd be the opposite. And in times of crisis like this, I think people's hearts are softened and they're more, you know, open to hearing the gospel. And we saw that in Ukraine as people were distributing, you know, food and supplies. Every box of food had a book for them to read, had some glow tracks, and they were able to have physical nourishment, but also have physical as well, and spiritual nourishment. So the Lord provided another miracle. There's a group of volunteers, Gideon Rescue Company, and they go out and respond to disasters, and they were a few that said, hey, we want to go to Ukraine as well and help. Well, they've been praying that God would give them a million glow tracks, and they've been praying for years, and they thought that maybe somewhere in the United States that miracle would come to fruition, and they would have this supply of million glow tracks that they would then go and distribute around the world. Well, the Lord used this war in Ukraine and a very generous man to donate to a printing house in Poland. And as they were conversing, the man said, you know, well, we need to print some glow tracks and distribute in a time of need, because people at this time are losing hope. You know, they may be able to find some food here and there and get by, but really hope is what keeps us all going. Once you lose hope, you lose everything. Well, as they started talking, the guys from Gideon Rescue and this donor and then the printing house, the man says, you know, I think we need to print a million glow tracks. And they were in shock. They said, how did he know that we wanted to distribute a million glow tracks? Well, the next challenge was, where do we get the paper for this? There was a shortage of paper, and they started printing. They had about 200,000 that they had printed, and they were out of paper. And so they started to look for other sources to find paper, and God provided. And this is some copies and examples of the glow tracks that were printed. And here they are at the train station distributing the glow tracks, distributing the bottles of water, talking to people, praying with people, both the young man in the red jacket and the neon green jacket there came from the U.S. as volunteers to help in that region. And they have now, since the beginning of this project until now, they've distributed more than half of what they set out to distribute. And so they're making a really good, you know, progress. Even though it's a war-torn country, they're still able to reach people and distribute clothing, food, basic necessities. Lots of medical supplies were distributed. We opened up a wish list on our Amazon page. And you wouldn't believe it. People from all over the United States would buy different things off of that wish list that would then get shipped to our house. And then we would box it, package it, and then it would arrive in Ukraine by a freight container that was on a shipping container. A boat that would go across the waterways and make it to Ukraine. This is some of the medical supplies. They made a little triage area there with medical supplies. They could assist people that were in need, that needed different wound care or needed maybe a tourniquet to send out to the mission, into like the main front lines as part of their mission. And so God provided in miraculous ways, despite the war, despite the challenges there in Ukraine. You can see people lining up at the clinic where they were distributing the medical supplies and food and books, clothing. This is one of our clinics in Kyiv, Ukraine. All these people would come out from the early morning until the very, very last hours of the day, and they would come and ask for supplies and for things that they needed for life. You see some of the pictures of, you know, the destruction and the war, some buildings completely torn down, some fallen from the impact, some were hit by missiles, and you see all those things that take place. This is a missile that exploded and beat on this building here, and many other apartments and complexes and schools and community centers have been destroyed because of this conflict. one of the volunteers there in Ukraine was out a regular day, right? Just the norm now. And there was some of these tanks that had been blown up and damaged and destroyed. Some of the ambulances that were donated from Germany and from Poland and other neighboring countries have been brought over to Ukraine to serve the needs of the people there. And regular vehicles would be packed and used to distribute food and supplies. And so really the Lord is working despite this crisis, despite this war. God is still reaching the hearts and the minds of the people. And so that's been really my takeaway, is that 2 years ago, Ukraine was very secular, very closed off, very anti-religion. And today with this crisis, the churches are packed. There have been multiple pictures that I've seen online where the local churches in Ukraine are just packed, full house. People are turning to God because they are hopeless. And we have that opportunity as believers to share the hope that we have in Christ with the people that we come in contact with. And so that's been my experience with the war and the situation in Ukraine. And really, what we can learn from this is that it's never too late to share hope with someone that we come in contact with. The students went out to Santa Cruz this Friday, and one of our outreach events was to grab a health magazine and distribute that health magazine to make one friend in that whole area, and to give someone a health magazine that would share hope with them, that would share about the Sabbath, that would share about some of the main truths that we have. And that was just another fun thing to do, to be able to share our faith, even as we're having a day of recreation, a day away from volunteering and serving. We could still be able to reach the people there on the beach. And so we're excited that we're here to partner with you, to serve together with Monterey Bay Academy. And we look forward to the service that God is preparing, that He would prepare our hearts as the students will be sharing the messages that God put on their heart. For our offering this morning, we will pray together here. And as you exit out of the sanctuary this morning, we'll have offering baskets at the end there that you can leave your offering, and it will support the local church budget. So let's pray this morning and ask God's blessing. Father, this morning we're grateful for the opportunities that you give to us to come together as a body of believers, that we can trust in you, that we can abide with you this morning in your house of prayer. Father, I pray for each student that will be speaking, that you would give them strength and courage and boldness to share the messages that you've prepared and put on their hearts, and we as the listeners would be receptive to those words. Father, we pray for the offering that will be collected here and given at this service, that you would bless the hands that are giving, and that you would multiply the offering, and many more can be reached with the efforts this morning. Thank you for being with us. We ask and invite for your Holy Spirit to lead throughout this service. And may your will be done. We ask and we pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
So we're going to be singing a few songs with you this morning, and we invite you to sing along. We tried to pick songs that you would know, so we didn't have them up on the screen. The first song we're going to sing is Come. Now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give your heart to God. The next song we're going to sing is Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God and His Righteousness. And the last song we're going to sing is Sing Hallelujah to the Lord. Thank you for singing with us. At this time, we're going to have children's stories, so we ask any children and any young at heart to join us for children's stories. We have a few up here that are young at heart.
Was too thin to walk. Well, so one day, my neighbor looked out her window, my dad's neighbor looked out her window, and she saw Duke trotting up to the house. And she saw that he had the bird in his mouth, and she thought he had killed the bird. And she was really sad, but she opened the door, and Duke set the bird on the ground, and it wobbled around, and it was fine. Well, she called my dad, and she's like, how come Duke came to my house instead of your house? And he's like, well, I was gone. And he had just gotten back, so he didn't know that Duke had gotten the bird from the lake. And they looked at the bird's wing, and they realized that it had been shot by a hunter. And so they were talking, and they're like, they decided they would take it to a bird sanctuary because it needed to heal up. And in the summer, they were able to release it, and it was able to go back with its friends, and it healed up. And you know, Duke is like God, and the bird is like us. Sometimes we swim in circles and feel like we make the same mistakes over and over, but God is always there to pick us up and put us back on our feet because he cares for us and loves us. Okay.
And the verse that goes with this is Deuteronomy 31:8. And the Lord, he is the one who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed.
Okay, that's it. You can go back to your seats now.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. We are so blessed to be here and helping you all this week on campus. It's a beautiful campus. And I would like to invite four of the students up. They're from the 7th and 8th grade, so they are middle schoolers. We're from Emerald Christian Academy in Oregon. And they had some things on their hearts that they would like to share. So we have Easton, Nadia, Rihanna, and Dinesh. And they're all eighth graders. And before they start talking, I would like to invite Easton up for opening prayer.
Please bow your heads. Dear Lord, as we reflect on the opportunities of service from this week and look at how we could grow from our service to others, we invite and seek your spirit. We ask that you bless each speaker, give them confidence, and most important, we ask that our time together will bring glory to you and your name. Amen. And our first speaker is Nadia George.
Thank you, Easton.
Okay. So when I was presented the idea of doing a sermonette in Bible class, I originally was going to do it on another mission trip I did to Mexico, but I decided after hearing what some of my other classmates were going to be sharing that it wasn't personal enough, and so I wanted to do it about my life and some of the experiences that I've gone through. So I'm Nadia George, and when I was 6 months old, my parents divorced. Shortly after that, my dad moved to California, and my mom married my stepdad. Because I wasn't in school yet, I traveled between their houses from time to time. Yes, it means the 8-hour drive between Eugene and Sacramento. around that time, I was 2 years old, and my mom had my little sister, Addison. And then a little bit after that, my dad moved to Sandy, Oregon. With my other grandma. I was still traveling between my families, and so it was really tricky because when my mom had my sister, I was still traveling between them, and so divorce hasn't always been a really easy thing, and so it's had its highs and lows, but you're probably wondering why I'm telling you all this. So I was still traveling between them, and I thought this would be relevant today because I wanted to connect it like this. I started out with just my two parents, and then because of an unfortunate event, my family was beautifully multiplied. That's my sister, and then me meeting my grandma and moving to California and meeting all these other people in my life. Just like the sermon Jesus gave on the mountain, when a little boy brought two fishes and three loaves of bread, and then Jesus multiplied it into something so much more. Shortly after I moved from California and then to Sandy, Oregon, my mom had my other sister, Braylee, and she's been completing our family, and I'm so lucky to have all of my sisters in my life. And then a little bit after that, my dad moved to Washougal, Washington, and married my stepmom. And then she had my two twin brothers, Levi and Ellis, and then after that came my little sister, Gwendolyn. Divorce is usually not looked on as something that's like a blessing, but I wanted to think about it and take it like this. If it wasn't for an unfortunate event that happened when I was really little, I wouldn't have any of the people in my life today. I probably would not even be here speaking in front of you. And so it's really, I thought I wanted to share that because that's a piece that's personal to me and that I think matters. And I'm probably not the only one who has gone through divorce, or you probably know someone who has been divorced or something like that, and so I thought it'd be relatable. But I wanted to say that God does beautiful things unexpectedly. We all go through really hard situations, and I know probably I'm not the only one going through something difficult at this time. But even if you don't see it yet, God is still working in your life, and he's still doing something beautiful even if it hasn't been portrayed right in front of you. And it doesn't always go as planned. Divorce isn't something that I would have wished upon myself, but I'm really glad it happened, because if it didn't, I wouldn't have people like my stepdad, who stays up really late to do math with me every evening, or my mom, who's teaching me gardening and even teaching me how to cook and doing all the things to be better and bettering myself, or my stepmom, who watches all of the crazy shows that I like to watch with me and has sleepovers in my room when I'm there, and my dad, who is doing his best to show me how to get through my life and doing my things that make me a better, more well-rounded person, even when he's not there for me all the time. And my siblings, who are just like keeping me on my toes all the time, and that I am able to share my wisdom and insight that I have too. It's really special, and if it weren't for that unfortunate thing in the beginning of my life, none of that would have happened. And so I wanted to share it as like a piece of hope that you can have as you're looking out, and just know that God is with you through all the hard things that you're going through, whether it may be divorce or a family problem or whatever you have going on. And even if you don't see it yet, I trust, if you have faith, I think God can do wonderful things in your life. And now I would like to invite up Easton Mariazzi.
So my story is about me growing up, and where, how, basically, how my childhood ended up. So first off, I started living with my mom and dad for the first four years that I was, I don't know how to explain it, but the first 4 years from when I was born, I was with my mom and dad, and they were doing drugs during then. And when I hit 4 years old, I moved to foster care, and it went on for about 5 years until I was like 7, 8 or something like that. And during the time I was in foster care, I wasn't really taught anything. I wasn't taught how to do math. I wasn't taught how to do anything. I wasn't playing sports. So I had to teach myself how to do all these things. And I taught myself how to play basketball, football, basically all these things. And it was really hard. And I kept switching back from going with my mom to my dad. And finally, a couple years ago, I moved in with my dad for full custody. And my mom went to treatment and got better. Ever since I started getting older and like seeing more things that I had never seen before, were marijuana and stuff like that. And I started doing marijuana and doing bad things. And I started getting bad grades and doing all these bad things. But I started, I saw that the way my dad ended up when he started doing marijuana. And I realized that if I started doing that, that my life would end up not having a job, sleeping on the streets. And so I decided to start believing God. And God fixed my life around. And if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be here right now. And I have a Bible verse to go with what I'm saying. Second Peter 3:18. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and forever. Next speaker will be Rihanna.
Hello, everyone. My name is Rihanna. A couple months ago, I was on a plane with very bad turbulence coming back from California, going home with my family. It was this really small plane, and the luggage were falling out of the things. They were falling down. Like, people's drinks were spilling. Like, the turbulence was really bad. The whole plane was shaking. And me and my family all held hands and started praying for our safety so the plane wouldn't go down. A little while after we prayed, the turbulence stopped and the plane landed safely. This teaches us to always have faith in God no matter what circumstances we're in. Proverbs 1-33, but all who listen to me will live in peace, untroubled by fear of harm. When in fear, pray to God and he shall deliver. When you trust in God, he will come through, just like when me and my family prayed to him on our plane and we landed safely. Even if it doesn't work out, just know that God has a plan for us and he will always still love us. Now Dinesh Naidu will be speaking.
Hello everyone, my name is Dinesh Naidu and my story is about how I discovered the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I was about 10 or 11 and I had this dog named Bernie who was, I believe, 12, really old and I guess on the verge of death, and he got really sick and I guess my family thought it was over for him. So in a last hope, we had my uncle pray for him, and I didn't really know what that meant. I didn't understand, and he prayed and he told us about it, and we waited a couple of days and then he got better, and I was completely mind blown, and I started to follow God and believe in God, and that moment really changed my life, because from there on I believed in God. And the verse that is tied onto this story is Mark 11:24. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. Thank you very much. And for closing thoughts, I am welcoming up Mr. Gaylor.
Well, my name is Doug Gaylor. I'm the principal at Emerald Christian Academy. And I don't know about you, I'm not gonna make you raise your hand, but who of you amongst yourselves has ever been selfish? I can tell you, I was a very selfish baby. I think all of us can relate to being selfish babies at one time, but I was especially selfish. When I was born, I weighed 2 pounds, 14 ounces. Back then they didn't have neonatal, who knows what they had back then, but my mom couldn't even hold me for the first 2 months after she even gave birth. So I was a pretty needy child, pretty selfish. I think all of us tend to have those selfish moments in our lives, whether we're young, whether we're old, and it kind of goes against service, really, why we're here, why our school is here, why we're able to work with OSTOP and his organization, service towards others. And so I was trying to think about what service means. And as I was thinking, I kind of reflected back on some of the ways historically that service has taken a role. And I want to go back to ancient Rome. And one of the festivals that they had in ancient Rome was Saturnalia, around the winter solstice. So my 7th and 8th graders, we were just talking about equinoxes and summer and winter solstices, so they'll understand that. But with that tilt, that 23.5 degrees, we get our seasons. And of course, back then, that Roman holiday, one of the things that they did was they would kind of swap places so that if you were the master and you had servants or slaves, for a day the slaves could be free and the masters would do nice things for the servants. That throughout the course of history, some other times that has been mentioned. In Ethiopia, on the day of Christmas, they play a game called Genna, and it's kind of like field hockey. And on those days, traditionally, the servants would play with the masters, or the landlords and tenants would play together. And so it was this mixing of the groups. And of course, if you've ever played field hockey or ice hockey, you know you can check extra hard. And so you can just imagine how hard checking those servants were when they would check their masters, or when the tenants would check their landlords. Again, switching, trading places, the master serving the servant, the landlord serving the tenant. In 1871, the UK, they officially adopted Boxing Day as a holiday. Have any of you ever celebrated Boxing Day? Nobody out there. Well, I have to tell you, one of my first experiences with Boxing Day, and this usually happens on December 26th, and typically it's a time when maybe the more affluent, maybe the more individuals with more means are able to give gifts to maybe different groups, maybe groups that work for them. But my personal experience with Boxing Day was when my wife and I had been married for a little while. We took our girls up to see Grandma and Grandpa, and Grandma and Grandpa basically came up to us and said, "Hey, how would you like to go sailing tomorrow? How would you like to go out on a cruise, a Christmas cruise in the Puget Sound?" We said, "Hey, that'd be great." And so we got out there on this Christmas cruise, and we were on a 60-foot yacht, beautiful yacht, and my wife's cousin was the captain of this yacht throughout the year. He's a ship designer, and so this woman who is from Canada, she has a couple of different yachts, and so his job throughout the year, when he's not designing ships, he's taking her wherever she wants to go, and he's the captain, and he's making sure that him and his wife, they are serving food to them. But on this one day, they switch roles, Boxing Day, and so here he is, and he's on the yacht, and it's almost like it's his yacht for the day. He can go anywhere he wants, and the owner of the yacht came and actually helped serve food to all of us. Now, this was our orientation to Boxing Day. And, you know, I think Jesus talks about service and how sometimes roles can be switched. There's lots of biblical examples of service in the Bible. How many of you grew up with My Bible Friends and My Bible Stories? You know, yeah, a lot of you. And I remember My Bible Friends, and one of them that really sticks in my head is Captain Naaman and Little Maid. The story was something like Little Maid and Captain Naaman or something like that. But, you know, that was something that was kind of, I think my mom especially liked me to read that story a lot, because I had an older sister, and we would argue and fight. And anytime dessert would go around and it was passed to me first, I always made sure I got the biggest piece before I passed it on to my sister. So maybe my mom was trying to get me a message. I don't know. But the point is, you know, if we read in 2 Kings 5, she's only mentioned in one verse. You know, here she is. She's been stolen from her homeland, and she's been taken to Syria, and now she lives with this man who worships idols. Nothing at all the way she was raised, but yet she had been taught to serve. And in her heart of service, instead of maybe taking revenge when Captain Naaman has leprosy, she thinks, what can I do as a servant? What can I do to help him? Because I not only serve him, but ultimately I serve the living God. And we all know the story. He goes to the prophet and he's cleansed from his leprosy. We really don't know too much more after that what happened, but you can only imagine if the great Syrian general, the stories that he told, what that did, how many people found out about the living God because of that. And then, of course, we have the story of the Good Samaritan in Luke 10. We know that Samaritans were not on really good speaking terms, shall we say. And here we have a Samaritan, side of the ditch. And we have all the people walking by, and then finally gets to, here comes someone, and they see the Samaritan in the ditch. And they take pity on him, they walk over to him, they help him up out of the ditch and pay for him. And then, of course, you know the question at the end. Jesus says, you know, who is loved the most? Who would this man be most appreciative of? You know, who showed the most love? And all of them had to say, well, obviously it's the person who helped him the most. And, you know, it just kind of goes again to service. taking away that selfish heart that by nature we have. Sin kind of gives us that selfish heart. I want to end with probably the last example of service, and it's found in John 13, 4 through 7. And it's one that you all know. Jesus, this is Passover. Jesus knows he's going to be crucified. He's going to really do the ultimate service in giving his life in service for us so that we can be recipients of his grace. And the disciples are there, and as is customary, somebody has to wash the feet. Nobody wants to do it. And then in verse 4 it says, "So he got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. Then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with a towel he had around him." We know what happens next. We know Simon Peter, "Oh Lord, no, you can't do this." And Jesus says, "Unless I wash you, you won't belong to me." And then, of course, Simon Peter replies, "Then wash my hands and head as well, Lord, not just my feet." Jesus tells him, "You don't understand now what I am doing, but someday you will." You know, I think that's what it is like for all of us, whether it's we're middle school students, maybe we don't fully understand what we're doing when we're serving, or as we're learning how to serve, but someday we will. And then in verses 12 to 17, after washing their feet, he put on his robe again and sat down and asked, "Do you understand what I was doing? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, because that's what I am. And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you." And a lot of times we stop right there when we have communion. But if you keep reading, "I tell you the truth, slaves are not greater than their master, nor is the messenger more important than the one who sends the message. Now that you know these things, God will bless you for doing them." As we've had a chance this week to be here on your campus and in your community serving, not only has that really been a blessing for you, but ultimately, the biggest blessing has been for us, because we've been able to grow and we've been able to draw closer to Jesus in finding out what it means to be a servant of him. So we thank you for giving us that opportunity. And ultimately, we give all glory to God, because he's the one who changes our hearts. He's the one who takes that selfish heart and gives us a heart of service. And as we move here forward, I just pray that for each of us, we can have that heart and we can have Jesus in our lives, that he can truly change us each and every day. We are going to have special music by our group. And after that, there will be a video that shows you a little bit more about what we have done this week. So at this time, I'm going to have the 7th and 8th grade students come on up. So this is a song they chose. And as they share with you what a beautiful name Jesus has in their lives, I hope you understand and appreciate what a beautiful name he truly does have.
Lord, with God the Lord, my
Well, I'm sure you're all excited to see what has happened this past week. I know I'm excited to see a review. We have had many different projects, about 35 of them, and it's been fun to see just everyone jumping in and tackling the task at hand. Some tasks were heavy. Most of the tasks on Tuesday and Wednesday were wet, but nonetheless, we powered through and got those things done. You know, we would have this walkie-talkie that we would hold and walk around and see what was going on in all corners of this campus, and the warning would come on, hide, get shelter, the rain is coming. And sure enough, the clouds rolled in and the rain came down. And then just like that, the sun would come out, the wind would blow the clouds away, and we would get back to it. And so we want to roll a quick clip for you and show you what has been accomplished this week. Wow, what a fun week it's been. Amen? Amen. We want to thank everyone that's come out, and I'll ask one of the students here to come up to have closing prayer. We thank the MBA community for having us.
Please bow your heads with me for closing prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you that we got to have this wonderful church service together. Thank you that we got to have this amazing opportunity to come serve. And thank you that everybody has, we've made new friends, and that we've gotten to come closer to you and got to share the love of Jesus. And thank you that we've been able to make a difference. And in your name I pray, amen.
All right. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. This concludes our service this morning. We're going to have the rest of this day here at MBA with you. We'll go out to the beach and see some of the sights, and then tomorrow morning is a long road trip back to Oregon. So we thank you for having us, and we look forward to serving again. Blessings. Bye-bye.
Of the mountains I